In our last video, we defined Hausdorff spaces and conversions of sequences. Now it's time for us to study the properties of Hausdorff spaces and how these properties affect the conversions of the sequences. We will in particular study these three theorems. Let's start with the first theorem. Every finite point set in a Hausdorff space is closed. So, finite point set means a set that only has a finite amount of elements. Let's suppose that this finite set point is going to be A. So, to prove that A is a closed set, we will prove that A is equal to its closure, because we know that the closure of a set is a closed set. If you don't remember about the closure, then check out the video about the interior and closure of a set. And if you don't remember what Hausdorff meant, then check out our last video. We know from our video on closed sets that any finite union of closed sets is a closed set. So proving this theorem, given that here we would have a finite set, will be enough to prove it for the singletons. Because if the singletons are closed, then we can just take any finite union of singletons, which will result in a finite point set, and then it would be closed because of this theorem. So this is what we will do. We will prove that the singleton is equal to its closure. Then singletons are closed. For this, let's take some element x0 fixed in x, and we will be considering this singleton. So to prove that this is equal to its closure, we will see that if I take x, another element in the space, then what we will prove is that x is not in the closure of x0. Whenever I take an element that's different from x0, it's not in its closure, means that the closure has to be the element itself. Now let's use, for x different than x0, let's use the fact that our space is Hausdorff. So we know that there exist U and V open sets, U containing x, V containing x0, that are disjoint, such that U intersection V is the empty set. This is just Hausdorff condition. We have two points x, x0, and we know that there exist disjoint open neighborhoods of each point. And so, from this, it follows directly, because given that I found a neighborhood of x such that U intersection the singleton x0 is empty, because x0 is a subset of P, and then this intersection is empty implies that this other intersection is empty. So, using the definition of closure, we have that x is not in the closure of x0. So it must be x0 equal to its closure. And so singletons are closed sets, and so are their finite unions. The spaces where this happens, where singletons are closed sets, are called T1 spaces. So let's write that definition down. If X is a topological space such that singletons are closed for every element in the space, then X is a T1 space. Remember in the last video, I mentioned that Hausdorff spaces were usually called T2 spaces. The T1 condition is sort of the previous condition to having the Hausdorff one, and it's not as interesting as being Hausdorff. In this theorem, essentially what we are proving is that every Hausdorff space is also a T1 space. So now let's work on the second theorem. We have a T1 topological space, so singletons are closed, and a subset of the space. Then we say that a point is a limit point of A if and only if every neighborhood of X contains infinite elements of A. we had a video specifically talking about limit points and the relation with the closure of the set. So now we have, given that this is an if and only if, we have an equivalence, we have another definition for a point being a limit point. Every neighborhood of X has to contain infinite elements of A. Notice that this equality is only valid when X is a T1 space. If X is not, then we cannot say this. So this if and only if means that we have to prove both directions. So let's start this one. Well, this direction is actually trivial. The reason for this is that if every neighborhood of X contains an infinite elements of A, means that every time we graph U a neighborhood of X, then U intersection A has infinite elements. But then if U intersection A has infinite elements, well, U intersection A minus X will also have infinite elements. And so if this intersection is non-empty, then X is a limit point of A. Now let's do the other direction. And we will prove this by contradiction. So we are going to take a limit point of A and suppose that some neighborhood of X contains only finite elements of A. Then we will reach a contradiction, and so it will prove the theorem. Take some point in the space that is a limit point of A, and suppose that a neighborhood U of X is such that U intersection A is finite. And let's also suppose that it contains more elements than just the element X, and call U intersection A minus X. This is going to be a finite amount of elements, so let's just call them x1 up to xn. And now we are in a T1 space, so singletons are closed, and this implies that any finite list of elements is also closed. So this set is closed, and then X minus all this set is going to be open. So X minus this list is open. So what we can do is call P U intersection this set. Now U was open because it was a neighborhood of X, and this other set is open. So B is open, but U is a neighborhood of X. This list of elements does not contain X because we were removing it here, and so this set B contains X. So B is a neighborhood of X. X was a limit point of A. So if B is a neighborhood of X, then it should satisfy the definition of being a limit point. Well, let's check. B intersection A minus X. Well, this has to be empty actually, because B was taking all the elements in U except those elements that had A, because this list of elements were the ones that were in U and in A minus X. B is removing all those common points from U. And then here I'm also removing the only common point that was X. So this intersection has to be empty. B was a neighborhood of X, and this intersection is empty, implies that X is not a limit point of A. But then this is a contradiction with our hypothesis. And the contradiction came from assuming that I could find this set U such that the intersection with A was finite. So I cannot find such U means that every neighborhood of X will have infinite intersection with A. And that is what we wanted to prove here. Every neighborhood of X contains infinite elements of A. Now let's finally prove the third theorem. This theorem gives us the relation between a space being Hausdorff and the conversions of sequences. Remember, in our previous video, we talked about the problem with spaces that did not satisfy the Hausdorff condition. There were problems with the conversions of sequences. Well, this theorem is showing us how the Hausdorff condition helps us with the conversion. Whenever we have a Hausdorff space, then any sequence will converge to at most one point. So it can happen that a sequence doesn't converge, but if it does, then the limit will be unique. And this is what solves that problem that we saw on spaces such as some set with a trivial topology. We are still not removing all the annoying spaces such as X with parts of X. This space is obviously Hausdorff because given two points, I can find the singletons that separate them, so it is a Hausdorff space because it's the one generated by these sets. But here, the only sequences that converge are the constant ones. Try to think why this is true. So again, we're not removing this type of spaces, we will do so later on when we learn the separation axioms. But what's important now is that we no longer have these type of spaces, where maybe limits are very crazy and converging to more than one point. The proof of this theorem is surprisingly easy, and we will take advantage of the Hausdorff condition. So suppose we have a sequence of elements in the topological space that converges to two elements. Let's call them X and Y, with X different than Y. And now, given that X and Y are different, then we can use the Hausdorff condition to find two sets U and B in the topology, U a neighborhood of X, B a neighborhood of Y, such that U intersection B is the empty set. So what happens is, given that Xn converges to X, there exists n, 1, a natural number, such that Xn is part of U, because it's a neighborhood of the limit point, greater than or equal to n1. And also, given that Xn converges to Y, there exists another natural number, n2, such that Xn is an element in B, because B is a neighborhood of the limit point Y, for every n greater than or equal to n2. You can probably see what the problem is. Take n to be the maximum between these two numbers. And now, for every n greater than n, we have two things. Well, first of all the elements in the sequence are elements of U, because all these numbers are greater than n1, and so we have the first condition. But also, Xn belong to B, because again, all these numbers are greater than n2, and so we have the second condition. But now, U and B were disjoint, and here we're finding an infinite number of elements that are in both sets. There you have your contradiction. And this proves that it must be X equal to Y. So if the limit exists, then it's unique.